Good afternoon, everybody. Like I said, my name's Emma Teasdale. I'm the Community Involvement Officer working for Healthwatch Oxfordshire. I'm chairing today's webinar. And today's webinar is around health and care services and how they will change in Oxfordshire. We have Dan Leveson here today from who is the Place-Based Partnership Director for the Buckinghamshire, Oxfordshire, Berkshire West Integrated Care Board, or as an acronym, BOB ICB. Dan's going to deliver a presentation for us this afternoon, and then there will be an opportunity for questions. Dan, I have received a couple more questions to the ones that I sent to you the other day. So when you're ready for questions, if you can let me know, and we can perhaps ask the four that we've sort of got in front of us to start with, and then we can open the floor up or open the screen up to anybody else that has questions. Is that okay?
Sounds good, yeah.
Fantastic. Right, well, over to Dan.
Now, I can't screen share, so will you be sharing my slides?
There we go. 3 years, give me a chance and I will make you a co-host. See, after 3 years, I slacked.
Well,
should now be
there we go.
Got it?
I think so.
Fantastic.
It's Zoom, right? So I'm used to Teams, but there we go. So I can see slides. Just Emma, give me. Can you see slides?
Yep, I can see slides.
Fantastic, great. So yeah, thanks very much for inviting me along. Like Emma says, I suggest I've probably got about 10, 15 minutes worth of presentation. Maybe not even that long. And then yeah, really happy to have a little discussion and answer any questions anyone might have. And I should apologize as well if I cough in the middle of this. I'm hoping I'm at the tail end of a cold, but it's difficult to tell at the moment. So a little bit about me before I start. So I'm Dan Leveson. I'm Place Director for Oxfordshire, part of the Integrated Care Board. So there's three Place directors. There's a place director for Berkshire West and a place director for Buckinghamshire as well. And I'll explain a little bit about the role in a minute, but a little bit about me before I start. So I've worked in the NHS for about 15 years. Before that, as you can see from the photos, I was an aid worker for about 10 years. So I began my career in the Balkans in Bosnia and Kosovo before moving into Eastern Central Africa. Worked in Ethiopia and then Afghanistan, and then finished finally in Democratic Republic of Congo. My NHS career started as a commissioner, and then I worked for 7.5 years with Oxford Health. And then most recently, I was over in Buckinghamshire as Director of Strategy over there. So I have quite a breadth of NHS experience and voluntary community sector experience as well, which I think really enables me to kind of think a little bit differently, I hope. So a little bit about now this is the simplest diagram that there's lots more complicated diagrams that I could find, but this is the simplest diagram that I'm using to explain our new system that came into force with the Health and Care Act in July last year. So we've been established, there's 42 integrated care systems. There's two statutory bodies within those care systems, the Integrated Care Board, which is who I work for, and that's essentially the NHS statutory organisation responsible for the NHS funded part of our system. And then there's an Integrated Care Partnership, which is made up essentially of statutory and non-statutory bodies across the whole system, so local authorities and NHS organisations. And the responsibility of the Integrated Care Partnership, and hopefully some people have seen it and been involved in it, was to set the strategy for the system, which it's recently done and published, that was approved at the board last month. And I think what's really important, and where I pause a little bit normally on the Integrated Care Partnership, is above anything else, I think it's symbolically very important. It's the only place that you will find NHS and local authorities fully signed up to a direction of travel for the health and physical and emotional health and well-being of the entire population of Buckinghamshire, Oxfordshire and Berkshire West, so that 1.8 million population. So I think symbolically, it's a very important step for us. Now, within the integrated care systems, there's been some emphasis put on place and place-based partnerships that I'll talk about a little bit at the moment. So we're made up of three places. In the guidance, it doesn't really tell us how we should operate, what we should do. So it's open, it's been left open to interpretation, but the key bit is that's seen as the engine room of a lot of the work to join up health and social care services so that we can improve the health and well-being of the local populations and communities and neighborhoods we work with. The other area that is developed as part of the Health and Care Act is this, the idea of provider collaboratives. So for a long time, we've worked in a system that's been quite competitive. We've been governed by quite strict procurement rules and regulated in very siloed ways. There is this new Health and Care Act, and our new system is enabling us to find new ways of delivering better value care, so new ways of collaborating, working together, creating partnerships and things like that, which I think is really important. And they're either going to be done at a place-based partnership, so pooling and aligning budgets, or they're going to be done by provider collaboratives, so specialist providers coming together to deliver specialist care at scale. And so that's essentially what this system has created for us. If people are interested, I'll try and share the link. On the King's Fund, there's a really good explainer animation. I don't know if people have seen that, but it's really worth looking at. And it's about 4 or 5 minutes explainer animation of why we've made the changes, what the changes are, and what the potential impacts are. So I really recommend, probably they do a better job of explaining it than I do. So this is our system as a whole. So like I say, so the big system we're a little bit more than that budget now, so probably closer to £3 billion, 1.8 million populations, about 40,000 staff. Lots of different people involved in it. I've done an Oxfordshire one as well that shows what we're playing with here. And so it should say one mental health trust there, not two. So Oxford Health is our mental and community health provider. We've got obviously the Oxford University Hospitals as our acute provider. We've got about 20 primary care networks. So that's our GPs that work at a bigger scale than just the GP practices, normally 30 to 50,000 populations, pharmacies, universities, our county council and districts and city councils. So lots of different stakeholders and people involved in it. And that doesn't really even scratch the surface of the voluntary sector and the community sector and all the informal care and stuff like that that happens and we know happens on a regular basis. So what's my job within the system? I'm just going to try and minimize this so that I can fully see my slides. There we go. So I can't see anything now. So please, Emma, do shout if anything goes awry or you need to stop me at any time. So the role of me as a place director, primarily my responsibility is to convene the leadership from across the health and care system and create a thriving partnership. And I think I'm very deliberate in the way that I talk about a thriving partnership. So there is a temptation within most of our system and structure to start to put in place lots of complicated and important structures and governance. But if I look across actually global examples of best value integrated health and social care systems, they rely primarily on really good, strong relationships, people that know each other, trust each other, transparency, and the ability to share the burden and our problems together. So it's a really deliberate and important thing that I'm emphasizing. It's what we, and I'll come on to who's in the partnership, but it's who we are and how we behave that really determines our success. So I'm connecting the key statutory and non-statutory organizations together. We're leading the development of new models of better value care using data and population health management. So much more emphasis on people, putting people at the centre, and trying to design care around populations rather than populations having to travel and transfer to different services across the area. My key responsibility is to speed up the delivery of integrated priorities, and really that's the joining up of services. The people, identifying the populations that are going to benefit from more joined up services, and then accelerating that joining up. And then how I'm going to do that is either aligning or pooling the budgets that we have. Like I say, we have a lot of funding and resources out there already. Arguably, if we would step back from it, it's not really grown and kept up with demand over the last 10 to 12 years, but there is a lot of resources out there, and it's how we leverage those resources to make the best impact. So this is our place-based partnership, and this is where what I said at the beginning, if you think about the integrated care partnership and the representative over a large geography, the representation on our place-based partnership, which is where Veronica and I have been this morning, actually, we meet monthly, and it's got Stephen Chandler, who was the interim chief executive of the Oxfordshire County Council, is now the people director for the Oxfordshire County Council, as Martin Reeves has come in as the new chief exec. Mark Stone represents our city and district councils. That's really important, particularly when we start to think about what has influence over health and wellbeing. So things like parks and travel and transport and access to leisure facilities and jobs and homes and things like that. Nick Broughton, who is the chief exec of Oxford Health. Megan Apandit, the chief exec of Oxford University Hospitals. We've got ANSAF, director of public health. Importantly, it does say Rosalind Pearce. It needs to be updated to say Veronica Barry, so the director of Health Watch. Now, they are very keen to make it clear that they are a member of the partnership, but they are there to represent people and patients' points of view at that partnership. Laura Price represents the voluntary sector, and then I have three GP leads, so for North City and South. So Joe McManus for City, Michelle for the South, and Toby in the North. So again, if just stepping back from that list for a minute, which is a long list of names and job titles, that represents pretty much all of the health and social care resources that are delivered in our county. Whether it's at neighbourhood level, at locality level, at county level, all of the resources are there. So what we're trying to do is take responsibility for using those resources in a different way, wherever we can, to deliver the best value. So the role of our partnership, joining up services, again, from a lot of the work that Health Watch has actually done, what we know is it's quite complicated for people to navigate some of our systems and services. So what we want to do is join up services as much as we can, making them seamless and simple and innovative as much as possible. Now, innovation can mean some of the digital innovation, but it can also mean different models of workforce, different people delivering different things in different places. So really trying to think differently about how we do things. There's a big task for us to reduce inequalities, so particularly for deprived areas and minority groups, but also people who are homeless, people living with learning disabilities, people living with severe mental illnesses, all of whom have worse life expectancies than they should do, and the years that they do live are often lived in poor health. As a county, I think Oxfordshire has, we know that we have 10 of the most deprived wards in our county. If I look at public health outcomes, actually, we're some of the worst places that we perform are, so children eligible for school meals, i.e. children living in deprived areas aren't school ready very often. So that's worse than national average, as well as our social isolation, which probably represents the dichotomy of our county to a certain extent, where we have lots of urban, very deprived areas within a very wealthy rural area with lots of social isolation in some of those more rural areas, as well as the new housing, which brings with it social isolation. So really a focus on trying to close that gap for health inequalities. And you'll hear a lot about that, I'm sure, in the next weeks, months and years, because it is a growing area of focus. and then designing this system so that we can be sustainable. So make the best use of the resources that we have and reduce our carbon impact. So as a public sector provider, our carbon footprint is quite significant. For example, pre-COVID, the levels of people, I think it was something like 1 in 5 car journeys at any one time was going to an outpatient appointment. Some of the digital innovation has really helped us to start to reduce that carbon impact, but there's lots more that we can do. So this is where I have a sense of optimism, and you will get a sense that I am optimistic about this. And I know we've gone through quite a lot of, and I'm sure there's many people on the call that have seen all the different restructures in the past. I am optimistic about this restructure. I do feel like we're moving from our legacy system, so a system that was organised around specialties and services, to a system that's organised around people, and I'll show you some examples of that in a minute. I do think we're going to try to move away from the temptation. There's always going to be a temptation to measure the processes. So how quickly we do things, how quickly people get something is important, but actually thinking much more about outcomes and costs, which is the value. So how do we achieve a certain outcome that's important to someone at the lowest possible cost is probably the best value care that we can deliver. Moving away from a fee-for-service based on volumes of care. So for a lot of years, we had activity-based payments that drove costs up. We need to look at how we can bundle payments together for full cycles of care. So getting your knee operation with your physio and with your the other things around you that are going to make the difference for you. And then moving away from organisations having to compete for lots of services to a much more collaborative way of working. So I do think the most successful organisations in our next generation of health and social care are going to be the most successful collaborators, as opposed to previously where the most successful have probably been the ones who can compete the best, can win the most contracts, can get the most income, can be the biggest. And I think we will see a change in that, and we are seeing a change in that. The design principles that we're committed to, it's a little bit disconcerting because I can't see anyone, but I'll assume everyone's still there. So what are the design principles that we're sticking to? Again, like I say, I want to develop a thriving partnership so that we can eventually receive some of the functions that are already done at an integrated care board. So I would like as much as possible to make decisions at a local basis. I think we have to evidence that we're mature enough to do that, and we have a partnership that can work together to make decisions together. We'll find opportunities to join up services and deliver better value care. Like I say, that's the best outcomes at the lowest possible cost. We'll design and agree new models of care that use technology or different people to deliver care. So that's quite important. And we talk a lot about people working at the top of their license. So making sure that if you're a doctor, you're doing the things that really add value. If you're a nurse, you're doing the things that really add value. We support carers and the informal care sector to make sure that we recognise the value and the contribution of those people as part of a workforce. Identify new models of contracting, focus on collaboration and risk and gain shares. This is a complicated thing for us to do. We're all regulated and governed separately as organisations with separate contracts and CQC registrations and all of those kind of things. So there are some complexities, particularly as we move a lot of care closer to people's homes, in communities and things like that, understanding how we share and manage risk both clinically and corporately is going to be something that we have to grapple with and understand. And for a lot of, for instance, GPs and stuff, this is quite exposing. So how can we support general practice to manage risk in a different way? I do often reflect on, we can learn quite a lot from the transfer of in mental health. So the transformation that's happened in mental health over the last 30 to 40 years from institutional-based care to much more community-based care and how that's done. We have to involve voluntary and community sector partners as equal partners. And I think, again, I think we've made a good start by virtue of the fact we have Laura Price on our partnership who really represents the voluntary and community sector. I'm committed to making sure that we work with voluntary community sector, we contract suitably, and we don't do lots of short-term contracts with the voluntary sector. I think they, above everyone, need quite a lot of sustainability and certainty in the future. And again, and part of the reason I'm here, involve and engage people from all backgrounds in the decisions that we're making. So working with organisations like Health Watch, involving communities, working with our city and district partners, working with primary care networks, working with local community organisations to really design the right kinds of care and services for people. So what are the priorities that I'm focusing on? Like I say, I'm trying to focus on, as opposed to services, I'm trying to focus on people and populations, the people and populations who I think will benefit most from better joined up care, our children and young people. Obviously, if you think about the range of services that families and children often interact with, it's an obvious place for us to focus our attention. And if I think about the opportunity to prevent illness in the next 10 to 15 years, that is the population that, if we don't get that right for the 0 to 5 year olds now, that will be our long-term conditions and multiple illnesses in the next 15 to 20 years. So it's really important we work with them. Adult mental health and wellbeing, working with partnerships with the local county council, with the city councils, with voluntary sector and Oxford Health to redesign our adult mental health services over the next 2 years. People with urgent care needs, primarily that is people with more than one long-term conditions and frailty. But I think it's quite important, and some of the stuff that we talked about this morning, it's really important that we find a way of managing the people that don't really require much continuity of care, that do require something on the same day. We find a way of getting them to the right place so that primary care and others have more capacity to support the people that need, have more complex needs and have a need for more continuity of care, whether that's a district nurse, a social worker, or a GP. And then the final, not strictly speaking population, but area of work is health inequalities and prevention. So there is a conscious and active shift towards focusing on reducing health inequalities and preventing illnesses that we've probably not, certainly in the NHS, we've not done a huge amount in our, I mean, we do, I often say, so the NHS's contribution to health is about 20%, 80% of our health and well-being is determined by the wider determinants, the social determinants of health. So that's our jobs, our houses, our social lives, our access to leisure facilities, the environment that we walk in and live in and things like that. So really joining those things up so that we can have and begin to influence people's health in a much more a different way, I suppose, as opposed to just being here to treat illnesses. And then finally, this is the kind of structure that we're heading towards. So we have a children's trust that's chaired by the council. We've got an adult mental health and learning disability and autism delivery group that's led by Oxford Health. The Oxford University Hospital leads our urgent emergency care board, which is the integrated leadership board. And then Director of Public Health leads our health inequalities board. The things that we are focusing on, and I think if I start from the right hand side, healthy behaviours. So how do we support people to stop smoking, have access to better foods and better diets, be more active? How do we as anchor institutions help our employers? So we're one of the biggest employers between the NHS and the County Council. We are one of the biggest employers in our county. So what is our responsibility? How many of those people that work for us live in the local areas that we've talked about? How many of those people live in some of the areas of deprivation that we can support and have a real impact on? And then health protection and things like that. Going that way, the integrated leadership board, focusing on integrated community services, really thinking about what services we can get for people. And we already have some of the stuff that we've done over winter. For example, we opened the urgent care centre over winter at the John Radcliffe, led by primary care, with the intention of managing people on the day, some of that on the day demand, integrating some of the stuff people may have seen around virtual wards on Panorama, looking after, using the technology so that we can look after people in their homes. And really, we have something called the transfer of care team that's really bringing all of our discharge services together so that we know the longer people stay in hospital, the more deconditioned they become. The best place for people is in home and in their communities more often than not. So doing everything we can so that people are supported in their communities and get home quickly from a hospital stay. And then the adult mental health, we've just awarded Oxford Health a 2-year contract to transform adult mental health as a system, working in partnership with local authorities in the voluntary community sector and primary care. It's a really important part of our work, and particularly if we think about 1 in 4 of us at any time may experience a mental health problem. So it's prevalent, and a lot of good integrated care is built around mental health. And then the learning disability and autism, what we know about the life expectancy for both of these populations, but particularly people with learning disability, is it's unacceptably low. And so we are in the process of transforming the services and care that we provide for people with learning disability and autism. And then finally, and importantly, children. I think I've mentioned my emphasis on early years and school readiness. So as a system, we have an early years strategy that we're committed to. And I think it's really important that we ensure, particularly for children living in our deprived areas, that we equip them with the skills that they need early on. I think Michael Marmot talks a lot about one of the biggest determinants of people's life and their life expectancy is school readiness. So if we're accepting that children living in deprived areas are not school ready, then we're accepting that those children may or are likely to die significantly younger than they should do, than their peers that don't live in deprived areas. Similarly, improving the services that we provide for children and adolescent mental health, and working as a system to improve what we do for special educational needs and disability. So I think that is it. I hope people are still there and I'm not talking to an empty room. I have, no, that is we, very, we dis, still, very disconcerting.
We still have a room full of people, Dan. We've still got lots of people. Nobody's dropped out. So
fantastic. So
thank you for
that. I will stop, and I'll stop sharing if I can. If I figure out how. Stop sharing. There.
Fantastic. And that was a really informative presentation. There was lots of useful information in there. I hope that the attended found that really useful as well. Like I say, we do have time for questions now. We've been asked some questions prior to today's webinar, and I think if we get those sort of over and out the way first, if that's okay. I think a couple of people might even be here to ask their own question. So the first question was from Mike Gotch. I don't think Mike is here, Dan. This is one I emailed to you earlier. So his question was, could you during your session please address the issue of how public concerns, observation, experiences and suggestions for improvements are fed into the changing system and how effective that input is designed to be? For example, if better patient waiting facilities were badly needed at the Horton, purely hypothetical, how effective would that observation be and how quickly corrected and how the executive response would be publicised?
It's a big question. Yep. So take the example, the Horton waiting room example. So each of our organisations has their own ways of engaging through the PPGs, through online feedback, through the PALS services and things like that. How quickly we can fix some of this stuff, you can imagine the long list of priorities and demands that people have and the lack of access and things like that. So there will be executive decisions that are made, but I suppose, and I don't know if Veronica or someone else in HealthWatch may want to comment on it, how responsive our organisations are to feedback and things like that. I suppose there's a range of different things on that. Just from my point of view about how we're going to involve and engage people differently. I think there's different organisations have better skills than we do at the NHS. I think we're quite a large organisation. We have various ways of doing it. I'm working very closely with Oxfordshire OCVA, so Oxfordshire Community Voluntary Alliance, who are going to help us really connect with local communities. So we are going to start with the most deprived communities, and I don't think I make any apology for that. Partly these are the quietest voices in our system, the voices that often don't get heard. And so we're working directly with them to engage local communities in what's going to make a difference for them. I think primary care networks and primary care have a big role to play. I think they know their populations and their communities well. But I think what I always say, where I begin and end with the how good are we going to be, this takes time, effort and resourcing. I think engagement and responding to what people tell us is not easy. We've got nearly 800,000 people in our population with a diverse range of needs and wants and things like that. And so time and effort and care in listening and responding is what it's going to take. But there is a sense, I do get a sense that we are all curious about it and want to do better, but acknowledge that it's difficult.
Thanks for that, Dan. I've just had another question. So what is in mind for grassroots communities, and especially in areas of health inequality, and how will you work with them, and what difference will they see?
Yeah, great. So one thing, I do worry a little bit that the grassroots communities and particularly the deprived areas are going to quickly get inundated and overwhelmed, but that may be a high-class problem for these areas. So what we've been discussing just this morning and what I've agreed with OCVA is I am committing or prepared to commit a level of resources that we've not actually committed before into grassroots organisations. So if we can find a way of contracting over the next 2 years with grassroots organisations to find culturally competent ways of improving emotional and physical health and well-being for those people, then that's what we're going to do. And so I'm starting with the 10 most deprived wards. So I intend to, over the next two years, have projects with those, directly with those grassroots organisations and linking them up with primary care and the acute providers and others. I'm doing the same for the homeless population. So I've just agreed to fund a post to coordinate. So I feel like there's a lot of work going on for homeless population, but it needs pulling together and coordinating and a little bit more sustainable approach to these kind of, thanks Maggie. The other thing that I'm doing is we've supported Active Oxfordshire, and I've asked them to focus on particularly isolated populations and particularly people living with long-term conditions and particularly people living with deprived areas. But one of the important things, and one of my observations having been in the job now 6 months, is I quite easily contract on a recurring basis multiple millions of pounds with our NHS organisations. But Health Watch, for instance, I seem to contract on a 12-month basis, and I don't really understand why. So one of the commitments I've made is to long-term funding for the voluntary community sector. So I hope this time next year, I'm sitting here saying that we've given kind of recurring, ongoing contracts to our voluntary community sector partners, because the trust, understanding and relationships that they have in communities is infinitely more than what we have, despite what we may say.
Mm-hmm. Lovely. Thanks for that, Dan. So this was another one we received prior to the webinar. We're a couple in our 80s and moved to Wantage 7 years ago and still cannot access an NHS dentist. As you know, private dentistry is extortionate. Is this likely to change in the future?
It is likely to change in that. So historically, things like dentistry, optometry and things like that have been commissioned nationally. That's been delegated locally. All right, it's still regionally, so it's still done at an ICB level. So it is likely to change. It is going to be more local, and people should be able to access dentists. And if they can't, I think going through the, and Veronica or someone may be able to help just on their understanding of dentistry, but getting to the dentist should be possible. And if you can't, then you need to follow the processes, contact our PALS team and things like that. But it's, there is, I think I said this morning, Veronica, didn't I? Well, I don't go to any meetings, even, and we were looking at the report that Healthwatch have just done from the stands at the OUH. And what strikes me is I don't go anywhere where I don't hear about access to general practice, the general practice estate, and access to dentists. So we do know that it's a major issue, and there are things that we're working on. It's a fairly slow ship to turn, but we are working on it.
Okay, thank you. I've got another one that came in this morning, and then I know there is a gentleman who emailed me, who's actually on the webinar, and might to ask his question in a moment. This was quite a complex one, Dan, but what I've just done is taken a snapshot from it. And this was from the coordinator of the Donington 50 plus group, who said, she'd like to ask for greater access to ways in which older people with complex needs can be met, with a reduction in costs of social service red tape and more time and attention given to listening and looking to the needs of the community. Grassroots needs with recruiting and training more healthcare professionals to give a more holistic, more sustainable and individual approach.
Yeah, it is a complex question. I suppose, hopefully I've answered some of that and given some reassurance that we are working with community groups. I think one of the things there's a slight obsession with more health professionals and things like that. I come back to, if 80% of our health and well-being is determined by things that are nothing to do with health, are to do with jobs, houses, social activities, things like that, there is something for us to move away. We risk medicalizing something that's not medicalized. So I think I'm quite keen. There's a lot of work going on with, and one of the things that I talk about quite a lot is so I talked about £1.2 billion health budget. That's just the health budget. That doesn't include the social care budget. If I was to add on if I put a cost on what happens in people's homes, the care that happens in people's homes with friends and families, with their neighbourhoods, with their communities, that would probably double. So there is something about how we value and work with carers, informal care, volunteers and stuff like that to support some of those kind of things. But there's a different way of thinking about things. There's no doubt we do have to try and find increased capacity in health and social care professionals. But I come back to, you know, to get a doctor, to train a doctor, it's 10 to 15 years. So it's probably not our immediate answer.
Okay, thanks for that, Dan. Neil, I don't know if you want to ask your question yourself that you sent in earlier on, or whether you want
to... Yes, I will. Can you hear me?
Yeah, different voice, Neil. This is great.
I'm going to have a question, yeah. But in view of the situation surrounding the Botley practice and the partner's decision to give notice on their contract, how does the ICB monitor the sustainability of the other 60-plus practices in the county?
So we have a primary... So we've been going through a restructure. We do have a primary care team. We've got a primary care director, I think, for the first time in our commissioning history, we've got someone who is a senior director with the sole responsibility of primary care. We're in the process, so there's regular monitoring. So we've got a team of people that work directly with primary care. I don't want to hide behind, it's complex, but there is a slight complexity with the status of primary care being independent contractors and all of those kind of things. But we do work closely with them. I think some of the stuff around working at scale, primary care networks and how they can support and improve capacities plays a role in it. And we're in the process of, so in the next 6 months, there is going to be a primary care strategy. And I think importantly, if people get an opportunity, the Fuller stock take really sets out what the potential future of primary care is. And there's a lot of commitment to making it different, but some of it is technical, some of it is purely kind of what can they stop doing, what can they do differently, what can we enable through. I think you've probably heard on the Today programme, the wonders of digital telephony and things like that, and triaging, getting people to the right place. Some of it is managing an expectation of people. Some of it is actually, and I try desperately to dispel some of the rumours. We do have one of the most successful primary cares in, certainly in the Southeast, if not nationally. Mm-hmm. It's something like, I think we see, this month I saw a stat that this month primary care has seen more people that this month than it did pre-pandemic. So they are seeing more people. Not all of it is in person, but they are seeing more people. It's just we've got to try and find different ways of getting people to the right place and getting new services in. So things like community pharmacies and things like that. But we do monitor and work very closely with primary care.
Could I quickly just ask a follow-up to that?
Yeah, please.
I mean, Botley had the CQC went into Botley did an inspection last October. And from what I can see from the report, the question of its immediate future and sustainability wasn't in an issue. Would you expect a CQC to flag up particular problems at all? Or is it so far out of their remit that they wouldn't do that?
Yeah, some of it is the fortune telling, isn't it? It's foreseeing the future. I think, so like you say, there's been quite a long history of working with Kennington and Botley on this. Mm. I think lots of effort and energy was put into turning things around, and it did improve, and it has improved over time. But I'm not sure that how far ahead we could have seen when, because I think there's elements of GPs retiring, there's elements of ill health, and part of it is there's also the long term stress, and I think COVID has had an impact on all of the workforce. It's been a particularly stressful time. And I do think anyone that was thinking about retiring in the next few years has probably retired. Anyone that was thinking about returning to work has probably thought better of it. Mm. So it is challenging times for us.
Anyway, I'm not a Botley resident, but I did focus on that particular issue there.
No, and it is. And I was actually just on a call before I joined here just about that. And it is a worry for us. I don't want to downplay the worry and what we're very conscious of, and whether this gives assurance or not, is we are really clear that our health and care system relies and is built on a really solid foundation of primary care. Primary care is fundamental to our success, so we are working very closely with them to make it successful. It is going to take lots of different things and different effort. One of the things that Veronica and I were talking about at the partnership today was designing a system where we can triage or having. So I think one of the consequences of how we've designed healthcare over the last 10 years is pathways have got longer. So it's quite difficult to get to the most senior experienced people. And if it was you and I, and if it was our businesses, we would probably put our senior decision-making as close to that first decision as possible, because that's the high value investment. And so one of the things that we're trying to do is seeing how we can get our most senior decision-making as early as possible in pathways, so that people get to the right place first time. And then we need to coordinate some of the services in a much better way. But that's one of the conversations that is ongoing with GPs. And I don't, by the way, I don't think AI is an option for that either. I think artificial intelligence offers some opportunities for us, but I don't think you can underestimate the importance of those senior clinical decision-making experience. Sylvia, you had your hand up.
Thanks very much.
Can I just interrupt before Sylvia? I've got a list of questions. Sylvia's fourth on my list.
Oh, right, I see. I didn't know if we were using the famous yellow hand.
I was going to get to the yellow hands once I've gone through the questions in the chat, because the chat box has suddenly come to life.
Great.
Firstly, we've got Becky Seaborn. I don't know if you want to ask your question that you put in the chat box yourself.
Hello, thank you. Yeah, I wasn't really sure how to frame my question, because I wanted it to be more specific, but I don't think I know enough to make it specific. But it was, and just as a bit of background, I've worked in Oxfordshire in a number of settings for a long time. I used to manage the Oxfordshire Domestic Abuse Services. I'm now freelance. I chair domestic homicide reviews. And I'm just really interested in everything you've said today. So thank you for sharing this information. And obviously I have a specialist area of interest that I want to advocate for. So just wondering how these changes and structures and your priorities, particularly thinking about health inequalities, will relate and translate sort of with the domestic abuse agenda and how that can trickle through to be really impactful. And I guess I just wanted to give one example of something that's happened recently, and some of you might know that the Domestic Abuse Act 2021 has barred GPs from charging for medical evidence of domestic abuse. But I happen to know from working with people who deliver the sanctuary schemes in the county, that actually the unintended consequence of that is that there are GPs who now refuse to give evidence at all. And obviously that's just hugely impactful for people that are experiencing trauma and needing support. And so that's just one example of where it would be sort of great to have a really sort of key strategic link all the way through to sort of frontline, particularly primary care services, but any other health and social care services as well. So I'd just be interested to know how it features and how and what the oversight mechanisms for that are, really, I guess, as well.
Becky, this is where I wish I knew. But this is the value of these kind of this is the value of these kind of things, because quite often there's stuff, as you can imagine, my job covers a huge amount, and I get very drawn into kind of integrated care for urgent people with urgent care needs. But actually picking up on what you're saying, there's the value of having these conversations and making sure when I go back, I will remind people that we need to think about how we're supporting victims of domestic abuse, gender-based violence and things like that. And also one of the things that I haven't actually said in my presentation, but one of the things that I'm really trying to do, but that will happen by this summer, but will be by December, is so the county does a joint strategic needs assessment every year. I don't know if anyone ever look at the joint strategic needs assessments? They're really good, and we do local insight reports. And what I want is to use the joint strategic needs assessment as the place-based partnership's core needs, so we understand really in depth not just the health needs, but the social and economic needs and things around crime statistics and things like that, and then develop a single health and wellbeing strategy. So we will always have, each of our organisations for sure will have strategies and delivery plans and operational plans and things like that. But if we can have one health and wellbeing strategy that really captures how we're going to work and then pick up some of that stuff, that's probably the best way. But I know that's a bit of a clumsy answer, Becky, to say I don't really know what the answer is for domestic violence, but thank you for raising it. And that's the kind of stuff that helps me go away and realize that there's so much more to this world than probably how I conceive it, I guess.
Thanks for that, Dan. Sue Frayling-Cork, you put a comment in the chat box. Would you like to ask that question yourself?
Yes, okay. Your message, Dan, relies on a lot of communication and intercommunication as being absolutely crucial, and we all know this. However, even as we talk, for instance, the Royal Berkshire Hospital doctors cannot successfully communicate with Oxfordshire. Now, this is ridiculous. If they can't get in touch with each other properly, with patient notes, et cetera, and then back to the GPs, however is this system of integrated care going to work?
Yeah, no, absolutely. And that's one of so we do have a digital strategy that's about to be published in the next couple of weeks. And again, Veronica, this is the joy of having Veronica in those meetings. So Veronica will have heard us talk about the emphasis that we have on it. Sue, you're absolutely right. The biggest barrier. So I've done a lot of work on integrated care. And I don't know if you remember a few years, probably pre-COVID, we were all obsessed with hubs were going to be the answer to everything. And we were going to have a hub and everyone was going to work together. In reality, I have never gone out somewhere that said we need a hub. Most people say we need Oxford University Hospital needs to be able to see primary care, needs to be able to see social care, GPs need to see what's been going on in ED and things like that. And so that is a priority for us. What we've agreed this morning in our meeting, we're setting up North City and South clinical operational groups where we have digital teams work with them to identify what we can do immediately, what's going to take a little bit of time, and what is beyond the realms of what we can really do now. Because you can imagine some of it is complicated information governance. Who owns that data? How do we share that data? Some of it is there's technology barriers to it that need investment, but some of it is purely of our own making. And where we can, we're going to streamline a lot of that. So you're right, so that is the barrier to it, and that's what we're overcoming.
Great, thank you very much.
Right, two more at the moment, and then we'll open up the floor to the yellow hands. We've got Suzanne and then Sylvia. You're on mute, Suzanne.
Oh, yes, okay. Well, thank you. I've got a very simple question, really. You haven't talked about funding at all. I'll give you an anecdote in a way. My grandson has recently applied to four different universities to do medicine, four rejections. Now, his grades, his top predicted grades, he's got a job at weekends, very mature for his 18-year-old. So how does that connect with what you're saying is what I'm wondering.
So this is where I'm trying to stay away from politics of this, but for 15 years, we've asked for a workforce plan. There hasn't been a funded workforce plan. And so that there lies the challenge. Actually, if we part of the problem is if we wanted more doctors now, we had to be training them 10 years ago.
Yeah.
And so what we're hopeful of, and Chris Hobson says there is a funded workforce strategy in with the Treasury now. So what we're hoping for is we get a comprehensive health and social care workforce strategy that is funded for the next 10 to 15 years. And I think that's the key thing is the funding of a workforce strategy. In the meantime, I do think there's opportunities for people to get involved in different ways. I think there's... We have vacancies all over the place. We run apprenticeships and things like that. We have people that are looking for jobs. So I'm trying to work with our local enterprise partnership as well to make sure that where we're trying to create skills and jobs and things like that, we link that in with the health and social care system and sector as well. But again, sadly, it is a simple question, but there's no simple answer to it because some of this is the politics of the NHS, I think. But yeah.
No, thank you for your reply. Thank you.
And if your son wanted to get any experience and wanted to even add to his things like that, then do encourage him to get in contact with any of the NHS providers and he can come and work in. And
thank you.
I mean,
I hate to say this, but he is from a middle class white background. And I wonder if that's one of the reasons.
I don't think there's an either or. I think it's and. So it's from any background. We're encouraging people to join health and social care workforce.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Suzanne. Sylvia.
Hi, Dan. I've got two questions. One's about primary care, as you'd expect. 2 years ago, I was working with the CCG on a big project looking at the usability of GP practices and whether they were fit for purpose. Has that work gone anywhere? That's the first question. And is there an expectation that more minor surgery, et cetera, will go out to the GP practices? If so, where's the funding to ensure they are fit for purpose? And my second question is there any possibility of patients who are going to access fairly minor and routine surgery at hospitals, is there any chance of their pre-op assessments being done at their GP practice rather than having to travel to the hospital and all the expenses that entails?
Sylvia, I don't know about it. If you contact me with the details of that work from 2 years ago, I can follow up with Julie and the team to see about that. Question about, are we going to encourage more minor ops in primary care? I don't know. If I'm being honest, I think one of the things that I'm worried about is if I'm saying we don't have enough capacity in primary care, I'm not sure that I really want to add more work into primary care, even if it maybe is more convenient for the population. I think primary care has a function and a role to play, a really important function and role to play, particularly supporting people to stay well in the communities and their homes. We don't have capacity to keep adding stuff. And again, you can imagine the problem with doing minor operations and things like that is you have to have a certain room with a certain standard, and there's all of those kind of things. So I'm not sure about that. Pre-op assessment and things like that, yeah, there might actually be creative ways of doing that online, digitally, and different ways of doing it. I did do some work when I was over in Buckinghamshire. We did some public engagement around, because one of our challenges that we haven't really talked about is the elective care backlog. So the number of people waiting for surgery generally has grown over the last 2 to 3 years, and we know why. And looking at, I asked people whether they were willing to try. Are people willing to travel? If it was once to go to a place that you didn't have to wait long, but you got your surgery and you were home say day, something like 80-90% of most elective care is done as day cases now. And I think generally people actually, assuming that the travel is good, assuming that people are nervous about the locations and not knowing them, but actually if we support people to travel, than they are. But the important thing is that follow-up needs to be local. So I think that's the dimension, working with all of our different providers to make sure that we do other follow-ups locally and things like that. And like you say, pre-op assessments and stuff like that. But there's some interesting stuff that we need to, as a nation, I think about. I use the parallel. I don't know if people buy, lots of people probably buy furniture online now, but people used to travel 2, 2.5, 3 hours to go and sit on a sofa in IKEA, right? And that was because it felt like a really important purchase. I just wonder how many people would be willing to travel 2 hours, get an operation that you knew was going to have a great outcome, and you only had to do it once in your lifetime. I think it's a way, and we're all at some point or another going to need to have some of those conversations and procedures. So, but yeah, Sylvia, drop me a line and I'll look into that a little bit.
Lovely, thanks, Dan. Bridget, you've got your hand up. You're the start of the yellow hands.
Here I am. following on from the compatibility about the computer technology, I wonder if you could, this may be a question I should address to my practice, but I've tried and I don't seem to get an answer, so I'll try it out on you guys. The compatibility of the telephone service. Again, we hear from other, I'm in Tame, so we hear from Unity, they've got a new system and it's marvellous. Our system at RICOP is the bane of everybody's life. And I assume, although my technological knowledge is pretty low, I assume that it should be possible to change the messages that one gets when one answers. Because the problem with our machine is that it's had the same message about COVID given out by a GP, charming man, who had left a year ago. So you can see how up to date it is. And as everybody says, they feel that they could kill him now when they hear him repeat the thing so often. So I wondered if telephone services, are they done according to the practice? Are they done according to the county? They're clearly not done according to Bob, which we hear about. And also, I mean, can these messages not be updated? I mean, we know at home our answering machines, we can change them. Can they not be updated quite easily?
Yeah, I'm sure they can. And it's interesting, one of the things that I think there is going to be some standardisation around GP phone lines. It's done at a practice. So it's this bit about, as a GP, it's your business, you choose how and where you spend your money, where you get the most investment and bang for your buck and things like that. So that's why there's variability in it. But it's well trailed and it's been on the radio. One of the big interventions is digitalization of phone lines for GPs so that it enables people to be routed to different places where there is capacity, put on hold, get callbacks and things like that. So it is in the plan, Bridget. And I'm sure I'm sure you are a member of your PPG, but if you raised it with your PPG, I would like to think that the practice would hear that and respond to it, particularly on an old voice message from a GP about COVID. So
the answer we were given was that it has to be an Oxfordshire system, and they've been trying to get it to change, and it hasn't changed yet, but they hope it will next year. In the meantime, we're still told by the poor old doctor about all the COVID regulations, which once you've heard that 10 times on a day when you're hanging on, it's not the best. So it is, in fact, the practice. OK, I am on the PPG and I don't mind speaking about it, so I'll have another go at the manager. Thank you.
Thanks, Bridget. Joan, yeah, you put a question in the chat and I think you'd like to ask it yourself.
Yes, thanks. Thinking about visibility and accountability of the Oxfordshire place-based partnership, how can the public track the decisions that you make, which will impact access, quality, and availability of health services? And how will we find out about your meetings, the agendas, and the minutes?
Thanks. So at the moment, it's informally constituted. It's not formally part of the governance. The way that you find out, Veronica's on there, so Veronica can provide you a regular update on what we're talking about, what we're discussing, and we'll be feeding back to the Health and Wellbeing Board. So I attend the Health and Wellbeing Board every 2 months or whenever that is, and we'll do formal reports and things like that. So it's and reported up into our the Integrated Care Board as well.
Thanks for that. Alison, you're on mute at the moment.
First one, so that's not bad.
I was the first one. You're still on mute, Alison. Let me see if I don't think I can unmute you. No, that's it.
Sorry, I'm getting my Zoom protocols.
No worries.
I'm a patient and I'm fascinated by the changes, and I think they're going to be very good if they come out the way you expected. But I'd like to get a better grasp of things, and I'd like to say, what impact would it have, for example, on neurology services? And I say I've had Parkinson's for 20 odd years. I just wanted to know, see how different it would be. Would it be any different from how it is now?
Yeah, it's a good question. And I think there are, so within what I do, probably not. Within the overall, where we create better services that create capacity, it means that we can enable improvements in things like Parkinson's and things like that. So it's there's probably knock-on effects from that. And then the opportunities, I think, the opportunities that working as a system at scale, so working in Buckinghamshire, Oxfordshire and Berkshire West, being able to compare, well, why does Berkshire West get that outcome? Why do patients in Buckinghamshire experience this or access in that way? Can start to, we talk a lot about unwarranted variation. So I think there's real opportunities to reduce unwarranted variation in things like Parkinson's care and stuff like that. So I would hope that you start to see some of that.
All right, would I still be seeing a consultant, or would it be more local?
So if, again, I can't really speak for your care, but if everyone, what I always say is everyone who needs to see the right person will see the right person. That will be determined by the clinical team, the experts and things like that. It definitely won't be determined by me in the little corner of my house. And I think that's the key bit is, if you need to see an expert, you'll see an expert. If you don't need to see an expert, actually, it's much better for everyone. It's the same as if you don't need to get in your car and travel, take a day off work and get someone to give you a lift and things like that. Let's try and just make it as practical as possible.
Good. And I just asked another one. Shouldn't really, I suppose. I had a lot of problems last year. And it was meant to...
Alison, can I just stop you there? If this is sort of personal, it's about your care. It's just that I just don't want to sort of, because we've webinars on there, sorry.
No, that's fine. If
you want to send us an email with a personal email with the information, and we can see if we can get that answered for you.
Okay, lovely. Thank you very much. Thank
you're
you.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Thanks, Alison. Dave.
Thanks. I think we need more advice and information and views on the role of primary care trust, practice participation groups, PPGs, where we, a couple of years ago, we had a system, well-developed system, where they had delegates on locality forums. The locality forums had a feed-in of information to the clinical commissioning group in Oxford. And then that was abandoned for some reason. It was closed down, although some of them still meet, some of the locality forums meet in some form or other. So it'd be interesting to know what the view is, either from Bob or from the Oxfordshire Place, about what their role should be. And to add a corollary to that is PPGs were shut down at the same time as the primary care networks were introduced. And again, should we be trying to get PPGs to operate across the network or not? It's all very unclear. It'd be nice to have some clarity and some help, because some GPs are not keen on PPGs, and sometimes you have problems because one part of the primary care network is involved, a very strong involvement with the PPG, whereas another does not. So it's needs both guidance and information on the views of what value you think they have.
It's not my area of expertise, and so someone else might be able to answer more precisely, but I definitely see the value of PPGs, and I think it comes back to that engagement and curiosity about hearing, because quite often it's things simple things that we can improve. One of my words of caution, I suppose, about PPGs is it's kind of what we need to do is amplify the voices of the people who aren't in the PPGs always, who are missing out on primary care and things like that. But I think, Veronica, you may want to add something about we do support PPGs still in the
ground. Yes. So, as you know, Healthwatch and Oxfordshire has supported, through Emma's work, the capacity building and sort of linking up of PPGs, but really the step they're also meant to take, which is working with the primary care networks, and that's still at a very early stage. And you know, there's a responsibility there for primary care networks to really value the patient voice that comes through their PPGs, and to make sure that that's reflected through to places like the Place-Based Partnership and the Integrated Care Board. So that work is still, you know, early days, and you know, I would urge that we see more of the primary care networks taking PPGs seriously and working to sort of support and build them.
Can I just add to that?
Yeah, Sylvia.
I was the chair of Botley and Kennington PPG up until 2 years ago, and we forged a very good relationship with our PCN PPG group, and I think the only way to do it is to just communicate with them and get involved with them, and I'd encourage everybody to do that.
Thanks, Sylvia.
Hello, Emma, you're on mute now again. That's £2 you owe me.
Oh, well. It's that famous phrase, it's never going to go away, is it? You're on mute.
Hello.
Michelle Evans, I think she's from Carers Oxfordshire, has had to leave, but she's left a comment in the chat box that said she would just like to raise the awareness of unpaid carers and the impact on them with community or home-based care and the transfer care teams.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's one of the things that I'm really trying, and again, changing this, there's a few things that I want to try to, in my brief time working in health and social care. One is the concept of the workforce. And I think if we start to recognise the informal care as part of our workforce, we would start to think about how we can support that informal care. And I think that's all ages. When I've looked at, if you think about kids that are providing care in homes and the impact that that has has on their schooling and the outcomes that they have in their lives and things like that. So it's a massive area that we just, I think for all of us, it's changing the way that we conceptualize health and social care. It's the same as thinking about beds in people's hospitals as opposed to thinking about beds in people's homes. And actually primary care is the care that happens in people's homes, and secondary care is maybe the care in GPs and things like that. We just need to step back a little bit, but absolutely at the front of my mind is how we support carers and volunteers and value that. Like I say, I'm sure it's being done, but I'd love to put a pound sign on how much care happens every day in people's homes that we don't even count, and I certainly don't pay for. But the value, just if I think about the value of that and the outcomes, it's massive.
Thanks for that, Dan. So I've got no yellow hands. We've got lots of people in the room now. Is there anybody else that would actually like to ask a question?
This is exhausting.
it's nearly the end of the day. It's nearly gin time, Dan. Nearly gin time.
Well, I'm about to drive to Bristol, so unfortunately not quite.
Jean, you've got a question for Dan.
It's not a question as such. It's just, I'm the vice chair of the Botley Kennington PPG, and I really would like to encourage everybody, wherever they are, to join their PPG. We are the interface between the patient and the doctors, and it's a hugely valuable thing to be. And it gives a voice. It also allows communication. And so for people who maybe are a little bit, don't know what's going on or a bit confused or whatever, I cannot recommend enough that you should join your PPG. And if you don't have a PPG, start one. I mean, we at Botley Kennington PPG would be absolutely very willing to help anybody, give advice on how it works. Our PPG currently now has 70 members. I think we're one of the largest in the country, and it is down to the work really that we do in encouraging people. So really, that's all I have to say. If you're not already in one, do join.
Thanks for that, Jean. Dan, if I can just interject a little bit there. On the Health Watch Oxfordshire website, we have a really, really comprehensive PPG, patient participation group pages. There's about 6 different pages. Talks about all about PPGs, talks about how to get involved, talks about PPG activity across the county, and also all the newsletters and information. If one of my team could pop the link in the chat box, that'd be great, so that people can have a look.
I think that's really good. And one of the things I think, like I've said around inclusion and inequality, I think I would encourage PPGs to go and try and reach out to the people that aren't always part of your PPGs. Go and seek out difference. My organisation is big and unwieldy. We're a long way from neighbourhoods and streets and things like that. Go and seek out the young people, the families, the less traditional people, because I can't stress enough, in all of my career and all of my experience, the value of difference in these conversations is so important. And I really, I don't have enough. That's why I joked about it. It is tiring, these things, but it's so valuable to hear from such a range of people. And PPGs is a great opportunity to really reach those people. So yeah, absolutely.
We've got Tommy, and I've got Beth waving a hand. Beth, I'll let Tommy go first and then I'll come back to you. Tommy.
Yes, good afternoon. Thank you, Dan, for your excellent presentation. However, I found there on slide 9 a point which I think is in somehow a contradiction. You once on left-hand side, you wrote, each organization competes for services. On the right-hand side, each organization, the organizations collaborate, but if the services are limited in their capacity, what's the point? The left-hand side and right-hand side will still have the same effect. They are limited in their capability. You won't be able to achieve more out of them.
Yeah, it's an interesting challenge. I would say if they're limited in capacity, joining those things up increases your capacity. If there's a lot of services that are providing care for similar populations, how we join those services up. So I will give you a fairly simple, well, is it simple? It's probably not, but I have a whole list of urgent care services. So I'm going to rattle off some really unhelpful acronyms now. So anyone in Abingdon, we've got EMUs, Emergency Multidisciplinary Units in Abingdon, in Whitney, and in somewhere else, I think. We've got RACU, Rapid Access Care Unit in Henley. We've got urgent care centres in JR and Horton. We've got GP visiting. We've got GP out of hours. We've got EDs. We've got same day emergency care, so ambulatory care. The key bit is maybe individually all of those services are resource limited, but if we were to look at removing some of the overlap and duplication and having it seamless, then that's how you create a more continuous, less competitive, less constrained service. That's my contention. I suppose, Tommy, if we're talking about are we funded enough? Do we have enough resources to meet the demands as we sit here today, delivering the care that we delivered as we do now? No, I think that's our challenge.
Thank you.
And Beth. You're on mute, Beth.
Oh, Beth, you're on mute as well.
Still on mute.
Yeah.
They're never going to believe this when I go back to work and tell them that I was on mute. But never mind. I have to agree with what you say about the PPG and sort of, trying to find those people who we think we are represented, but they're not on that committed to talk about themselves. Young people, very much so, because, my age, I don't think I know that much about them to talk about young people. But also, there are communities, and people always call us hard to reach communities. I'm sure if I went and burgled somewhere, the police would find me very quickly. But I do think that we should be looking at those communities too, to try and reach them, find out, how they access service, why don't they access service, and how could we make that pathway a bit more clearer for them and a bit more effortless for them so that they can, feel included in all this. So I totally agree with you. And I do agree with you also about working, in the community, working with other organisations, because rather than spreading yourself thinly, if you work with other organisations, I think you can reach far more people, you can deliver far more services, and you're helping that community to deepen the impact in that community also.
Beth, 100%, and look, if anyone tells you you're hard to reach, they haven't tried hard enough. I am sure.
They tell me that all the time. But
and we hear it a lot. I am 100% sure that we don't have hard to reach communities. We don't try hard enough to reach those people in those communities. I know, and I'm sure you do, I can walk around the corner. So I coach swimming at Blackbird Leaves once every Friday, and I walk around the corner to the community centre, and I go and hang out at Dutch and such, and I go and talk to the people across the road. Those are the community connectors. Those are the people that we need to reach. And I'll just tell a story from my past. I have genuinely travelled to the corner. I did a needs assessment in the northwest of Niger a few years ago, and this was in the Sahel, and so we traveled 2 days to reach a community. Now that's hard to reach, but we took the time and effort to go and do it. And so part of it is we've got to make a bit of put the time and effort into reaching people. I think it's a really easy thing to say people are hard to reach. And why would someone come and to me if I don't look like them, I don't speak like them, they don't trust me? So why am I saying come and talk to me? There's some obvious simple things that we can do, but that's why I'm really determined that we work with local community, because those local communities know they know who they are and what works and what doesn't.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Beth.
Thank you.
Thank you, Beth. We are getting very close to the end of our webinar time. We've got one more hand up. So, Amy, we'll make yours the last question and then we'll have a wrap up at the end.
Yeah, hi. I just wanted to ask, kind of follows on from Beth's question as well. What's been done to reduce the stigma and bias and things that are actually involved in healthcare settings? Because we have a lot of people who would like to access services, but due to the reception that they get when they try and get into services and try and get into GP practices, they're not very welcomed. So I'd like to know what's, you know, is there anything being done about that? Or is that something that could be shared at some of the groups that are being formed? Because I get a lot of feedback to say that, you know, I work specifically with the homeless population and we have a lot of feedback saying I walk in and, quote them, the Rottweiler on the door won't let me in.
So, yeah,
needs to be stuff done to get rid of some of that bias and stigma and stereotypes and people just looking at people thinking, oh, you're a drunk, you're a druggie, you're a homeless person, you know.
Yeah. So one of the things I think we can't tolerate it. So from a leadership point of view, nobody should tolerate it. And so, Amy, when people experience that, I think, like we say, if there's a PPG that knows about it, then I think that needs to be raised. If the practice doesn't do something about it, then raise it. There's this thing about speaking up. We've got to call stuff out. We've got to acknowledge where behaviours are inappropriate and do something about it. And so I would encourage everyone when you hear about that to raise it with your practice, the practice manager. And if you don't have any success, come back to us. As a system, we're doing quite a lot of work on it. I think it's, Amy, I think it's a relevant question given what we're hearing about the Met, what we've seen about the fire and rescue, what we know about NHS health and social care services. We have a long way to go. The fact that I'm stood here today as a white, middle-class, heterosexual male who's place director for Oxfordshire, you know, I there's a lot of work that we're doing to change how we recruit people. There's a big emphasis. We have something in the NHS called the Workforce Race Equality Standard that has really shone a light on the experiences of people from Black, Asian and minority ethnic backgrounds working in health and social care, the challenges that they face. It's very difficult for people to get recruited up into senior posts. I think some of our areas are better than others. We're very lucky actually to have not only a medical chief executive of one of the biggest acute hospitals in the country, but a woman of colour in that role, which I think fills me with pride when I say that. But there's a huge amount that we can do, but we've got to be brave and bold to call it out. And if it's any consolation, I am an ally in all of that, and so we'll always stand up. And I've spent most of my life working in social justice and things like that, and so that's why I feel very confident speaking out about it. And anything that I can do to support, but it's there's a journey to go on. And I suppose to come full circle to some of this is societal. We have built a system and a society that accepts some of the stuff that we really shouldn't accept. We built a system and society that makes it easy for people like me and more difficult for other people. And so we've got to do things to change the system and the processes, not just, if I go on any more unconscious bias training, I'll scream. It's not about how much I understand my bias. It's about how biased the processes are. So let's change some of that.
Amy, thank you for your question.
Great question to finish on, Amy. Thank you.
Can I just say a word before we do finish?
You can. Can I just add two things, Sylvia, just to let everybody know, if they do still have a question, I have put in the chat box, please email the team at Health Watch Oxfordshire, and we will make sure that question gets over to Dan. And Veronica has put the information also about how you can feedback about services that you've used. Use our feedback centre. Please feedback that information. Thanks, Sylvia.
Okay, thanks, Emma. Thanks, Dan. It's been a really, really interesting session. And thank you, Emma. Thank you for everything you've done for Health Watch. for anybody that doesn't know, Emma's leaving us today, reluctantly. We're very sad to lose her. It's purely a funding issue. We still don't know whether they have the funding for that post. But we love you lots. We'll miss you lots. What more could I say? Thank you.
Thank you, Sylvia. And thank you, everybody who's come along to these webinars for the past 3 years. It's been an absolute pleasure.
And thank Emma, I'm not going to put you on the spot anymore. So thank you for inviting me. Thanks for being so thoughtful and diligent in putting this together and guiding me through it. Thanks for chairing it in such a good way. Thanks everyone for your participation. I'm happy for people to contact me directly. I can't guarantee that I'll always respond to it, but I'll try to. And yeah, I'm happy to come back. So thanks.
Yeah, and I'd just like to add thanks to Dan for a really good session, and thanks to everyone for your questions. And it would be good, we can invite you back maybe in 6 or 7 months' time, when things have got a bit more established, and we can, you know, continue this dialogue with people. And I'm really pleased to see that you're getting out and about and meeting some of these communities on the ground, and that, you know, you're really trying to bridge that gap between people in communities and the health system. So it's really positive. And Health Watch Oxfordshire, as Dan says, we do attend the place-based partnership in an independent role. We don't have voting capacity there. We're there to represent people's voice and also to be a critical friend where we can. So it's really important we can continue to hear from all of you about your issues and what's important and some of the barriers you're facing. So please keep communicating with us.
Thank you.
Great. Thank you very much, everybody. Thank you for taking the time.
Thank you all. Bye-bye.